First of all, I want to say how wonderful it is to see so many faces here today to help celebrate Carol's life. I'd like to start by thanking the key people who helped us put this service together today. Wanda, you were given the gift of floral artistry. She created this beautiful Carol's English garden here in remembrance of how much Carol loved her garden. And Wanda, I am just so amazed that you were able to make that yourself. Thank you so much for doing that and the creation of all the flowers that you see here today. The ladies in the kitchen that are helping us with the food from the auxiliary, Mary Lynn, Virginia, Rachel, Sandy, and Carol, and I hope I haven't forgotten anyone. My brother is here today videotaping the tribute to Carol, and he will upload it on YouTube in about a week or two, so you can all share it with your loved ones and friends around the world, for those people who could not be with us today. And I have to say a special thank you to Nancy and Bob Booz, sitting in the front row appropriately as family members. They created the DVD that you saw here today, and you can see it again in the fellowship hall after the service as a reminder of all those wonderful special moments that we've had with Carol over the years. For those of you who don't know my story, I'm Jean Miller. I met Carol and Dave 33 years ago when I moved from New York City to work at the Exxon Pavilion at Epcot. I didn't know anyone in Central Florida. It was the leap of faith. But I called one of my friends in New York and she said, "Jean, don't worry. You just have to call Carol and Dave Bergman and they will introduce you to everyone, from doctors to my realtor to help me find the house." And that is exactly what happened. I did not know at that time that this introduction would result in the most positive relationship in my life. It was love at first sight for the three of us. God made us a family, and we chose each other as mother and daughter. We committed that we would always be there for each other, and we did. We kept our promise. Most of you probably know Carol, again, from her neighborhood, as a volunteer for the many, many organizations that she represented: Health Central, Rotary, Women's League, and of course, as Mrs. Claus. But for me, I'm here today to share with you that she was my chosen mom and my best friend. Carol taught me so many things. She was a master at networking, planning, making sure people knew how much she cared about them, and keeping the faith. Numerous times when I would say, "Oh, Carol," or "Oh, Mom, don't worry," she would say, "I don't worry. The Bible tells me so." And I can tell you, it was hundreds of times, and I never got it, but I still say it, and then before she could say, "I don't worry," I said, I know, the Bible tells you so. As I look back on our 33 years together, there is also a pattern of how she and Dave would support me in my efforts, and they always felt that I could do more than I even thought I could. And they encouraged me. For example, when I was part of the marketing team opening Universal Studios Florida, she and Dave decided to come and help and volunteer as senior ambassadors and started that program so they could be a part of this joy that we all share. Carol loved being out. Anybody who knew her for more than a few minutes knew that this was not a woman who liked to stay home and clean and cook and, you know, put her feet up and just watch TV. That was not her life. Her life was being out with people, helping them. And on those days when she couldn't, she felt a real need that, why am I out there? There's somebody that needs me to help them. What a blessing that is. We also share the love of themed events. We planned several table talk events at this church that was so dear to her. And with Nancy, and make no mistake, she was the leader just like she planned her service here today. And she planned and wrote her obituary a few years ago. She was always in charge, and she knew what was the right thing to say and do. She was the queen mom, and always the leader of our pack. She would dream all night about a theme. She would get so excited, and then she would call me in the morning for a table talk, and she'd say, "You know, Jean, I had a vision, and I dreamt that our table was all pastel colors and artwork, and I had my marching orders." And I said, "Okay." Then I would think about it, and then I would get on the phone with Nancy, and all of a sudden our theme was Dining with Monet. And another year it was, "Okay, again, I was up all night thinking about this, and I have it, and I know it's beautiful, and I love birds, and I hear birds talking to us and everything." And I said, "Okay, thought about it, called Nancy," and we had a rainforest theme. This went on for several years, and we had so much fun planning those events together. There was only one time that I was able to pull off a surprise, because she knew everything. She would know when I would sneak into her house and grab photos from a closet that she never went in so Nancy could have the photos for the DVD. She said to me one day, "Jean, I think someone's breaking into my house." And I'm thinking, how the heck does she know? She's never in that closet. There must have been 15 photo albums. So I had to get better at breaking in and putting photos back in the ways that I thought she had them before. But when she turned 80, as we called her the Queen Mom, we decided she needed a special celebration. So we rented Town Hall, and some of you were there for that important coronation of the Queen Mom's birthday. And thinking about, Heather was in the lake swimming with Carol, which is something that they both love to do together. And all of a sudden, it was like, I think, about 3:30, 3:45, and Heather said, "Okay, let's go in and change." And then she said to Carol, "Well, we have to go to the salon because you have to get your hair done." And she thought she was just coming over to my house for dinner with a few of us. And Carol looked at Heather and said, "Well, get my hair done." So we made arrangements. Heather took her. She had her hair colored, cut, and blown out. And then they went home, and Carol said, "Let's get ready to go over jeans." Carol pulls this pink, brand new gal out of the closet, and Carol just looked at her so perplexed, and she said, "What is this?" And Heather said, "Jean told me to have you do this. Don't ask me any questions. Just do it." So that was the nature. And poor Heather's like, "Okay, I'm not going to be able to get her there." So there comes Nancy and Bob, and they're heading in the car on the way to Town Hall. But the greatest thrill was to see her walking up the steps and with that look of amazement, knowing that something special was about to happen, but she didn't know what. And then the doors opened, and there was her beloved family from New Jersey and South Florida standing in the line to greet the Queen for her 80th birthday and her coronation. She loved it. We had a wonderful, wonderful evening. Then I have another special memory I'd like to share with you. It was when she was the mother of bride at my wedding. My birth mother called me and told me that she wasn't coming to my wedding here in Orlando because she knew that Carol was really my mother. And that was a lovely gift from my birth mother. Carol looked beautiful in her blue dress, and she was even so proud that she had her toenails painted blue. So through the years, when it was something special, and in the last few weeks of her life, I said, "Carol, I'm going to go out and get blue toenail polish. I'm going to paint your toes blue." And she would laugh. Carol was also known for her hugs. How could you not know Carol and not know how much she loved to hug people and feel that bear hug back? Nancy and I would take her to the Bloom and Grove for several years, and it got to the point where we would just have to stop every couple of feet because Carol would say, "Oh, there's Mary Lynn," or "There's somebody else. I have to go and get a hug." So one year, I think, Nancy, we got up to 55 people that we had to go and hug. but it was fun. If you would all humor me and stand up for a moment, I would appreciate that. And whether you know the person next to you or not, give them a big bear hug. Safari, but Carol was so proud when I got my first dog, KJ, of course named Sir Kendall Jackson after one of my beverages of choice. He had to stay with Grandma at the lake because my husband at that time and I were going to Las Vegas. Make a long story short, when I came back, there was a book full of pictures, and it was a letter written from KJ to Mommy about what he did with Grandma when we were away. We got a little crazy, you know, we're the ladies with the crazy ladies with the dogs. But when I came back, I said, what are you doing? She was feeding him Linerwurst sandwiches. And this became a trend. We all love Linerwurst for some unknown reason, but I have to say that now that two of my precious dog children are in heaven, I just can imagine the day that she went over there, greeting Grandma over the Rainbow Bridge, and running to her with Missy, and saying, oh, we're so glad you're here, but where's my Linerwurst sandwich? Because she, and you can see there's some pictures in the DVD of what she loved to do. I have a younger dog named Tootsie Couture, and she loves seeing Grandma at Golden Pond. I would drive over there, I'd shut the car off, and I'd open the door, and Tootsie would run out of the car like a bat out of you know where, run into Golden Pond, and all of a sudden, she knew where Grandma's apartment was. And all of a sudden, I hear this, ugh, because I knew that Tootsie jumped on the bed and landed on Carol's stomach. And then you'd hear Carol's sweet voice, and it would be, Tootsie, Tootsie's here. Oh, Tootsie, I'm so glad you're here to see me. How can you not love somebody who talks like that and loves animals as much as she did? In closing, as time progressed, we would have those hard conversations about the time when one of us would no longer be here. I told her that I would know that she was watching over me because, as she did many times when I would feel sorry for myself, she would tell me to go out and help somebody. So I knew that if all of a sudden I had this urgent need to go out and volunteer, it was Carol telling me, get up, stop feeling sorry for yourself, and go out and help somebody else. She also loved to hear me sing. And there were several different songs over the years, but the last one is one of my favorite songs from the Beatles called In My Life. And it says, there are places I remember all my life, though some have changed, some forever, not for better, some have gone, and some remain. All these places have their moments, with lovers and friends I still can recall. Some are dead, and some are living. In my life, I've loved them all. But of all these friends and lovers, there's no one that compares to you, Carol. And these memories lose their meaning when I think of love as something new. Though I know I'll never lose affection for people and things that went before, I know I'll often stop and think about them, but in my life, I've loved you more. The last conversation we had, she looked at me, opened her eyes and said, you look like my daughter. And I said, laughter was so much a part of our relationship. And I said, well, that's because I am. And then she smiled and said, oh, you look so pretty. I love you. And I said, well, "Thank you," and I said, "but I'm glad Joe and I canceled your eye appointment because, you know, I don't want to improve your vision." And she would laugh. "Thank you, Mom, for being the most important person in my life. The laughter, the love, and the tears. And I promise